Okay, so welcome to the next session, which is going to be done by Jaka from Ljubljana. Yeah. Jaka, as I have been told, is a guitar player and programmer and long-time Nix contributor, yeah, working on systems stuff. And that's what he's going to talk about today.
Yeah.
So welcome, everybody, Jaka.
Hello, welcome to my talk about running Kubernetes on XIS. I'm Jaka, and we'll talk about why Nix and Kubernetes are a great combination. Okay, so something about me. I'm, as it says, I'm full stack engineering, JavaScript, Python, C, and different other languages, with experience in provisioning and some embedded devices and security. Lately, I'm mainly backend JavaScript developer, but I'm interested and involved in wide spectrum of IT fields. One day, I'm fixing bugs of incompetent front-end developers, and other days, I'm doing some low-level hardware programming. So the projects I'm currently working is actually the first one is a startup called GitHub, and it's a new fintech platform for multi-currency payment trading and exchange. It's based on Ripple. We already got the CMOS, and we are and it's currently we are just releasing our new product that is for mostly for enterprise users. And the other product I'm making is actually data-driven distributed task automation and aggregation work using Graph databases and Docker containers and also Nix. This project is actually I'm making in my free time, and I also want to make a startup from it. So when I started working on GitHub, we decided that we want to split our infrastructure in many multiple microservices. So we started to think how can we deploy scalable infrastructure. Our developers wanted to use a Docker for development and deployments. So the questions were but I still wanted to use NixOS and Nix packages for our deployments. So the questions I had were how to deploy scalable NixOS systems, how to deploy scalable apps on top of NixOS, how to have reliable distributed storage and scalable monitoring. So I decided we need something like cluster process manager, secure distributed overlay networking, load balancer, distributed and replicated storage, schedule for different resources like power, networking, storage, and this all should be managed by some cluster manager, and there should be some monitoring system to actually see what's going on. To do everything, we have to start let's make an overview of what we have. So the first thing is decision of which container service manager we will use. So in that case, we have different choices. One of the first is usage of systemd. It's not like container manager. But the main real difference is for container managers, they actually run processes in containers, and for example, systemd also has this command called systemd anspawn that also runs processes in containers. And the other you will probably know is Docker. So main advantage of Docker is that it's user-friendly and provides hub of pre-made Docker app containers. It has two simple format for building containers. Idea behind Docker is that you run one app inside container, not the whole OS. Because if, for comparison, for example, with LXT container manager, where you usually run the whole OS in container, of course you can. I mean, whole OS, whole distro base image. Of course, you can also do this with Docker and with other container managers, but that's not how it should be done. Okay, the Rocket, I don't know much about Rocket. It's a new thing developed by CoreOS. It actually, they define some specification, declarative specification format for building images. And it's a bit different from Docker, but in a sense that you can, it's a bit different from Docker that it has more, you can specify more things because Docker has pretty much simple format for building images, and as I said, it's sometimes too simple. Okay, and then let's go to the overlay networking. Why we need overlay networking? It's actually to connect all these services together across different machines we are running, because we don't want to statically type in all the IPs. We just want to spawn these services across anywhere in the cluster, and they should connect to all other services they need. So in that case, we have a few choices. We have Open vSwitch. As we will see later, we use Open vSwitch with IPsec networking or across our cluster. And then we have also some other choices that there are more Docker related. For example, this Wave that simply enables to connect multiple machines. And I think they also use now Open vSwitch as a backend. CoreOS Flanel, not Flanner, Flanel. Flanel is actually it's not as optimized as Open vSwitch, because Open vSwitch has kernel support, so it's actually really low latency, and with Flanel you can there is a bit more latency because it's running in user space, and so in that sense, it's slower, but it connects to etcd. Etcd is distributed configuration storage. So whenever a new machine comes to a network, it automatically connects to this distributed networking. Docker is now working on Lib network. And it's not as developed as other alternatives. So to be actually able to run our services across different machines, we need to have some kind of storage that's remotely available or available on demand on specific server. So in that sense, we have a choice of different distributed file systems like Ceph, GlasserFS, and ExtremeFS, and also in cloud solutions like Amazon Elastic Block Storage. In NixOS currently, there is a model for ExtremeFS that Matej C was working on, and I don't know how well does it work. We still need, I would really like to have an XS model for SAP or GlasterFS that's better supported by cluster managers like Kubernetes and also Docker now. And then let's move to class managers that we can choose from. The first I will talk more about later is Google Kubernetes, and the others I will describe now. The second one is CoreOS Fleet. So a Fleet is actually a cluster manager that's managing systemd services across a cluster. It was actually, I think, developed before Docker was even so popular. But it's not so much developed now. So it's really nice because you can spawn systemd services across a cluster, and also probably NixOS could use it. The third one is Docker Swarm. So Docker is usually running as a single service that manages your containers on a single host. But if you use Docker Swarm, it actually distributes containers to many different nodes that are connected to it. So it actually exposes the same API as Docker, but it can communicate with many machines. And then you have actually Doku is not here a cluster manager. But I still put it on the list. It's actually like an open source Heroku written in Bash, and it's really nice if you want to deploy something simple application. And then the last we have Rancher. Rancher is a solution on its own. It's actually also using Docker, and it's actually providing its own overlay networking. They have pretty nice UI, but I actually spoke with the guys from Rancher and asked if, because their solution could only be start from Docker and then they provision everything. And I asked them if they could provide an instructions how to deploy it separately on the machines, and they don't have this in plan right now. So, but it would be really nice to see you, Rancher. What? Mesos, yeah. Maybe I forgot about Mesos here. Yeah, also. Yeah, Mesos actually. Mesos is actually also a cluster manager that can work with spawning not only containers but processes among the cluster, but it doesn't have built-in like support for networking and storage and stuff like that. But it's really nice distributed scheduler. For example, what would be nice to see is, for example, for Hydra task, for example, use Mesos. That's one nice use case, because all other cluster managers are more for running applications, but for example, Mesos is more for running, like I would say, tasks, but it can be used for different things. But you have many more available here on this link. It's actually, if you Google how to scale Docker containers in production, you find a long list of these solutions. Okay. So now let's say something about Docker and Nix. So Docker is primarily used for running application, not a whole distros. And of course, running Nix inside Docker is easy. A few benefits here we have compared to other Docker images is that you can pick the exact version of Nix and exact versions of packages. Because, for example, if you use some other images like, I don't know, Debian or Ubuntu, you can just select the which revision of distro use, and here you can actually pick the commit you want. Like, of course, you can add a channel and then install whatever you want. And yeah, it's really simple. I just I actually just pushed a new Nix image for Nix 110. And so you can pretty much easily make a Docker image and run it. So you can try this yourself. I will not run this now. Okay. This slide. So what about running NixOS in Docker? As I said, actually you can run NixOS inside Docker containers using privileged mode, but you actually don't want to do that because Docker was not meant for that, and that's actually more for if you want to like test or develop on NixOS, and you wouldn't do this in production. Now working, I was working on service abstraction layer that would actually abstract the services and provide a way to run, that you would be able to make like an XIS config and then build, and then make a separate container for every service and run this on cluster. But currently I have different things to do, so it's not in my priority list, but I think it would be a nice thing to do to actually separate services from NixOS, because NixOS is currently a quite monolithic system that So now let's go to Kubernetes. It's actually open sourced and announced by Google in 2014 and influenced by Google's Borg system. It's written in Go. Like actually most of these things I showed you before, is they are like written in Go. So mainly because Go allows to actually pretty easily build static binaries and distribute them anywhere. So that's also a Google's approach currently how they're deploying stuff. Kubernetes uses Docker as primary process manager, but also has support for Rocket. So you can make a Rocket image and run it in systemd. And I think Garbas was also working on making, also wrote an article how to build a Rocket image. So maybe we could try and run it with Kubernetes. So Kubernetes has a lot of commits, I would say, a lot of contributors, mainly because it's supported by Google, and it's currently for a pretty long time in stable release from the summer somewhere. So what does Kubernetes provide? It provides replication. So it actually manages Docker containers across multiple machines. It provides load balancing, so it has built-in load balancer that balances traffic across all the replicated services. It integrates with distributed storages like EBS, Ceph, GlasterFS, NFS. Now they added support for this fiber file system. And there are also some other storages like Git and secret storage, so you can put secrets and stuff like that. It has supports for resource quota, so you can say, okay, this process, I only allow this process to take this much of RAM and this much of processing power. It has built-in support for logging and monitoring, and it has declarative configuration for everything. So Kubernetes consists of many components, and these are separated in microservices, and here is the description of them. The first one is API server. It's HTTP API service that with on which you connect and control Kubernetes, and the changes they made are applied by a control manager, scheduler, Kubernetes scheduler, schedules resources, resources like servers, so it decides where to put some containers, and it also now has support for allocating storage. So we have, if you have a pool of storage, it can allocate it, but it currently this only works in Google Cloud. Then it has a proxy service. It's like load balancing proxy across for all the services we expose, and it of course has this kubelet that's actually running the containers themselves. So it manages containers and reports on containers. Okay, so here's the schema. So you usually run one master with on which you have deployed API server, scheduler, control manager. Okay, we have also here Hipster. It's actually a monitoring service for all these things. And then you have many they call minions. So many worker nodes where you have this kube proxy that's for load balancing. Kubelet for running services and also a DNS service. So they also integrate with this DNS called SkyDNS that provides DNS service for all the applications you run on Kubernetes. Okay, now about some terms they use. So namespace is a separate group for pods, replication controllers, and services. So you can have, like, for example, development and production namespace. It actually doesn't provide a physical separation between containers themselves. It only provides logical. So, for example, one container can still communicate with other container, you can actually write your own firewall plugin that would prevent this. Then there is a minion that's a worker node, a pod. They in a Docker world usually run one container, and then you can attach multiple containers together. Here, actually, you can run a set of containers on a single host, and they actually share the same networking namespace. So that's pretty nice, and they actually can share the file system between these containers. Then you have replication controller. Replication controller is a controller for group of pods. So you can say, okay, I want to deploy these pods, and I want to make this many replicas. So and you define this in replication control. We will see example later. And then a service is a load balancer for a group of pods that's running on Kubernetes. Okay, so maybe let's make a demo. Okay, so what we will do here is actually we will deploy on. It doesn't show everything. Yeah, okay, it's okay. So we will deploy. Here we have our replication controller. So what we will make here is we will deploy two Nginx containers. Okay, so let's do this. Okay, so I actually already have this deployed, but I can now first let's get replication controller. So we already can see that we have replication controller with of Nginx with two replicas. But we can delete this. Okay, so it now deleted our application controller. You can see that now. And now we made create with this file we have on the top. It's Nginx controller. Okay, so now we can see it's running one replication controller. In this replication controller, it's running two pods. One has already started, the other is almost started. So now both are running. Actually, maybe if I just make curl, it would be just fine. Because I said that these are exposed by DNS, so I can just make a curl like Nginx. Oh yeah, I forget something. We also have a service. We also have to expose this. So I already have a service available, but I can delete it, of course. And Nginx service. And I can actually go to the next slide that shows the service. So here is, maybe just describe this. So here we have a service that selects all the pods that have label app Nginx, and it exposes port 8000. The target ports on the container is port 80. So let's do this. Okay, now we have a service available. It has its IP dedicated, every machine has to have IP space for these services and for pods. Okay, so now let's do this curl. Nginx service pico default pico. Come on, just a second. Probably I have DNS problems. Yeah. I actually usually have different DNS server. Let's see if now works. No. Still not working. What?
This time it resolved. Last time it didn't resolve.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, the different port. It's a wrong port. It's 8080. Thanks. 80,000, not 80. Oh yeah. So here is Nginx responding, and it's load balancing between these two pods that are running. If you would have multiple machines, it would run these pods across multiple machines, so it load, so it provision them on different machines. That's what scheduler does. Okay, of course, here we have some additional commands. We can also get the logs of containers running in our classroom. We can access some command inside container and also have a shell to this container, but okay. Now about running Kubernetes on XIS. I created an XIS model, and it's deployed in production for a longer period of time. I actually been testing this for quite a long of time. I think from version 0.6, and now it's now we have version 1.0, so actually not the latest stable release, which is 1.1, but that's also what of most other distros have. And it's actually to actually deploy it, it's actually just a few lines of NixIS config. So what you have to do, it's like make a bridge interface. You have to make this your server to be roles of master and node, and to actually just define the Docker where on which interface that it should use this interface. So in that case, CBR0 interface. So you here you don't see enable. That's because with these roles you already defined that each kind of should be enabled. But I will probably change this so you will have to explicitly enable it. But currently, you just define of roles of services. You can of course also enable the different components separately. This is just a shortcut with these dot roles where you define master and node. But that's running only on a single node. For production environments, we need a list cluster of three machines, and one of which has to be a master and also a minion node, so also worker. And that's because usually in production, Kubernetes depends on etcd. Etcd is this configuration storage, and if you want to run it reliably, we have to have a quorum of to be at least two of three machines running, so that three machines kind of make a cluster that you can run in production. And you also, of course, need to have an overlaid networking, so these machines have to be connected somehow and have routable subnets. So actually, in Kubernetes, every machine gets its own subnet, and so services that are deployed on different machines can talk together and have different IPs that are routable to different servers based on IPs. So in our case on GitHub, we do it on Amazon AWS instances. And we have virtual private cloud. And on top of that virtual private cloud, we are running open vSwitch connected with IPsec because we don't just run instances on Amazon, but also on Hetzner. And with Hetzner, because we are communicating over the internet, we need some kind of secure communication. Then that's because that's why we have IPsec links. Then deployment is with NixOps, Elasticbox storage, and then we have separated production and development namespaces. And here is just high level overview how it looks like. So a couple of minions connected, and then we have Amazon load balancer. That's load balancing the traffic to these servers, and open vSwitch overlay networking connecting all these instances. Maybe just a bit about monitoring. We use Collector for metric aggregation, Inflexible for metric storage, Grafana in dashboard as dashboard for metrics visualization, Bosun for alerting. Yeah, as it says. It's actually we are currently using Bosun for alerting because I haven't found any better component, but Grafana will get in a next release support for alerting, so this would be really nice because then you would just have to run InfluxDB, Grafana and some service like Collector that collects the logs, and that would be it. Configuration. Actually, I will not show how to deploy a multi, how to deploy cluster now. But actually, I have available set of profiles, so you can include this into your NixOS configuration. And I have something like profiles.kubernetes.enable true, And for example, profiles.open we switch enable true, and it will and with a bit of options you you pretty simple configure all the system. Why I don't want to use bare NixOS config, because I reuse this this configuration in different deployments. So and I don't want to duplicate my code. So I have developed a set of profiles that I can reuse in different deployments. But of course, then it's still a better documentation. So that's about it. I think it's already time, right? For questions. Yeah, thank you.
So you do at which point when you deploy to when you build images, Docker images, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, when you build Docker images, you include the whole closure inside the image so they can be moved around.
Yeah, currently. But we are working on having distributed like Nix storage that would be,
which is mounted and across.
Yeah, that's the idea, but we are not there yet. That's the idea, and this would be really awesome.
Okay, I just don't. For me, it's like really you really need a big scale to benefit from all this big setup. Like you need to really have a good problem to solve this, to have this big setup.
I mean, it's just, for us, it's easier because, what's the size? We are running around 10 Amazon instances, around 20 microservices replicated. And then we also have like support services like GitLab, like Sentry, like, and Grafana, Elasticsearch. A lot of stuff. So, and actually, if I would have to deploy all this by, for example, GitLab is just deployed with image available on Docker Hub because this was much easier, quicker way. So, this setup actually enables you to run Nix services and also the other, and it enables us to later scale or replace it with a full Nix setup. So,
I was just curious on that topic with the copying the closures into the other containers. How big, you know, are you seeing your containers being, like, you know, for your Nginx container, for example?
Oh, Nginx. I don't know how big is it. It's a Nix closure size plus a few 10 megabytes maybe. Okay. So it's not a big container. The bigger problems are other services. For example, we have a lot of Node.js packages that could be really big in size. So if they have a lot of dependencies, this becomes...
Has that ever been a problem in actuality, or is it just kind of a...
Actually, we had problems with storage because when we updated it, if we updated it, for example, especially for Node packages, if you updated the Docker description file, and you update the version, it will rebuild the whole image with all dependencies, and it will be a different hash. Mm. And then you have a lot of, if you have a lot of updates, it will just fill the disk space. So now we actually have a garbage collector that runs every day and cleans the old Docker images. So it is a problem, and like distributed storage with Nix would be a really nice solution here.
Can you tell a little bit more about how the VPN works or the Open vSwitch?
Open vSwitch.
Between Amazon and Hetzner and stuff.
So Open vSwitch is a virtualized switch that's it's integrated. It's integrated in Linux kernel. So what it actually provides is to simply create virtualized networking, so we could say software-defined networking between machines. We are not using all the feature of it, but it provided us with actually not so easy setup of encrypted tunnels. We could also probably use just GRE tunnels, so it's like IPsec integrated directly in Linux, but I actually decided to use Open vSwitch because it kind of it has better support for routing. We could do firewalling in some sense with it, so we can actually limit communication between different containers in a cluster. So in that sense, Open vSwitch.
It integrates IPsec, or
you have IPsec is in Linux kernel. It's part of kernel.
Okay, and the configuration between the different servers, is that manual or?
Currently we deploy the configuration. It's static. It's generated by NixOps. So when I deploy it, and if I add another server, actually it reconfigures all the other servers to provide this mesh networking between machines.
Okay, cool.
So we need a better solution to actually be able to spin up servers just without NixOps, because
Okay, no problem. Thanks.